Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes, a ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher today is the director of Bible Tracts Incorporated, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample packet of all of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. And now for our Bible study, here's our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Hello, my friend. Welcome to the Friday edition here at Bible Tract Echoes. I hope you've had a great week, and I hope along the way that you've been able to spend time with other believers, not just, by the way, in your midweek service, and I hope you attend that, but I hope you've had time to spend with other saints throughout the week, not only to be encouraged by them, but to be an encouragement to them. And I hope along the way you've had the opportunity to impact the lives of lost people. And to help you do that, I want to give you some gospel tracts. I hope you know what a gospel tract is. And just in case you don't, in a moment I'll explain that to you. And I'm going to highlight one of the tracts. And I want to give you a free sample packet containing one each of all of our English gospel tracts. But I, right now, want to lead into our Bible study this way. Oh, by the way, if your Bible is nearby, why don't you get it and join me as we begin to look at the very, very last verses of Romans chapter 1. Get your Bible, open it to Romans chapter 1. Well, let me ask, are you a list person? A list person. Now, some people seem to be born to be organized and methodical in all that they do, and they love to make lists. Well, then there's the rest of us who only make a list when it's absolutely necessary. I've discovered that with the aging process, making lists becomes more necessary. Now, when my wife and I go to the grocery store, normally we have a list, but, well, that list really ends up being more of a suggestion. Typically, we see other things that we need or want. If we don't end up getting all the things on our list, frankly, it's not a big deal. I say that because today, at the end of Romans 1, God gives us three lists. These are not items to purchase. They are items of things that we already have obtained. God's lists are not suggestions. They are the factual reality of our lives. And when it comes to God's list, all we can do is, number one, own them, number two, repent of them, and number three, seek God's remedy to alter them. I want to show you the list. I want to encourage you to be more than just what these lists describe. Get your Bible, join me. Get a piece of paper so you can jot down some notes, please. I mentioned having a gospel tract in my hand. Now, let me begin by saying that a gospel tract, it's an evangelism tool. It's a tool that helps us extend our gospel witness to people even when we cannot verbally walk through the gospel with them. A gospel tract is a short, written presentation of God's plan of salvation. The tract in my hand right now is entitled, He is Not Here. He is not here. On the front face of it, there is a beautiful Easter lily. And yes, many people, churches and individuals, use this tract a lot at Easter season, and that's coming on pretty quickly, as you well know. He is not here. This gospel tract emphasizes the fact that in the world of many religious leaders, there is one who is the right man, there is one who is the risen man, there is one who must be the received man if we're to have everlasting life. If we're ever to be right before God, if we're ever to have our sin stain removed, dealt with, carried away, as far as the east is from the west, for that to happen, we need a Savior. There's only one. There is Jesus. He's the right man. He is the risen man. His resurrection proves that his payment, sin payment, on our behalf at Calvary was accepted by God, and we can now live and walk in newness of life because he is alive from the dead. Please, let's talk about the resurrection whenever we give out the gospel. Here's a great tract. He is not here. It's just one of the 40 tracts in the sample pack that I want to send you. Be ready when my announcer gives our contact information at the end. Or if you can't wait to the end, go to our website. You can order the sample packet there. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. If your Bible is open to Romans 1, beginning in verse 28, the Bible says this: even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who, knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Stop there. That's the end of the chapter. As I said, there are three lists in these five verses, and in a moment I'm going to give you my five-point outline for these five verses. I'm going to be using five words, all beginning with the letter F, like in the word food. Now, these five verses are the final part of a section that began back at verse 18. Now, my title for these verses, 28 to 32, is this: The Depravity of Morality in Man Against God. I'll say that again. My title is The Depravity of Morality in Man Against God. Now, why do I say that these are against God? Well, verse 28 opens with mankind not wanting to retain God in their knowledge. That word retain means to hold on to or to possess. Believe it or not, it's the word used over in Matthew chapter 1, where we're told that the Virgin Mary was with child. That word with and the word retain translate the same word. She was possessing this child in her womb. Well, sinners, when they don't want to keep God in their mind, they commit intellectual abortion by not holding on to that truth about who God is and what he's done. But then, that's the beginning of it. Then at the verse 32, it ends this set of verses by saying that the people know that God judges sin, but they go ahead and do it anyway. So these three lists describe our depravity, or in our depraved morality against God. All right, let me begin to walk through this passage using my five words beginning with the letter F. Number one is this: fault. Fault, based upon verse 28. What is the fault or the cause behind our depravity? Well, verse 28 says that we did not retain God in our knowledge. That verb there describes an action which was committed. It's complete, it's done, but it has ongoing effect. We committed spiritual, and it may not be a pleasant word, but we committed intellectual abortion in not holding on to the truth about God. Word number one is fault. Word number two is the word filled, found in the verse 29. We are filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness. Now, to be filled means that we are complete. We're in need of nothing at all to do all these things. That means we can do all kinds of things that are listed here. We can do them all. We've got all it takes. In each of us, saved and unsaved, is all that we need to do any and all categories of these things that are in this list. And that's list number one. Isn't it a lovely list? Word number one, fault. Word number two is filled. Word number three comes from the second half of verse 29. It's the word full. The first list in the first half of verse 29 tells us what we are totally capable of doing. Now, in the second half of verse 29, the second list tells us what specific things are already present in us. This list begins with the word envy there and ends with the word malignity. These are attitudes we already practice. This list is not a potential list of problems. This list tells us what actions and attitudes we already have participated in. And by the way, the word murder is in there. this is not just an idea of murder in a physical killing of a person's body. Jesus dealt with his standard of murder in the Sermon on the Mount, I think, don't you? Well, word number one, fault. Word number two, filled. Word number three, full. Word number four is the word foolishness. Foolishness based upon verses 30 and 31. What is the foolishness of our depravity? Verse 31 says that we are without understanding. Without understanding. Now, that word understanding comes from the same Greek root word that was used back up in verse 21, where it says that their foolish heart was darkened. The sin ugliness in us made us foolish. It made us foolish, that is, to understand, to put together, or to connect the dots in our relationships. What relationships? Well, our covenant relationships are mentioned there. Our marriage relationships are highlighted there. But then all of our other interpersonal relationships are dealt with based upon the list, this third list of things that we find there. With three lists so far. That brings us to word number five. Word number one, fault. Word number two, filled. Word number three, full. Word number four, foolish. But now, word number five is my word frolic. Frolic, based upon verse 32. Look at verse 32 again. Here is what it says. Who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but they have pleasure in them that do them. The word frolic I've used there, perhaps that's not a good word for you. Let me use another word. It's the word clamoring. To clamor after something means that we boldly, noisily, insistently go after something that we just must have. Verse 32 says that we, sinners, commit the same sins that are in these three lists here, and we take pleasure in watching others do them as well. And, by the way, the words commit and pleasure, they are not describing in the past. They describe words and actions in the present. They're both present tense verbs. This means sinners are doing these things right now, and they're continuing to do them, and they're continuing to love to see other people do them. That sure cuts into our entertainment industry, doesn't it? Now, with all of this ugliness put before us, you might be ready to ask this question. Brother Mark, since all this ugliness is in me and I know it's there, how in the world can I ever expect to live above this stuff? That, my friend, is the right question. It's a great question, and I think probably the best, clearest, simplest, straightforward answer is found in 2 Peter chapter 1. Verse 2 and 3 says this, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. And verse 4 says this, that we might be partakers of the divine nature. In every believer, there's new life. We share in God's life, and we can live out our new nature and not be enslaved by the old. Let's walk in newness of life. Let's walk in Christ-likeness using his power, because you and I have none. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes, a ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of all of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. That's 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. A faster way to contact us is to go to our website at BibleTracksInc.org. That's BibleTracksInc.org. There you will find more information about our ministry and details on how you can support Bible Tracts Incorporated. Thanks for listening, and may the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.